In order to mitigate the failures encountered when running timing tests on SDRAM devices using the DDR4 Compliance Test Application, this video demonstrates the approach to identify the suitable burst triggering technique and threshold settings so that the test application is able to find valid bursts and run timing tests successfully. To know more about the functionality of the application's user interface, refer to the online help for DDR4 Compliance Test Application. For information regarding the test implementation steps, required equipment, and licenses, refer to the Methods of Implementation document. Visit keysight.com for further help and support regarding the DDR4 Compliance Test Application. In this demonstration, we shall run timing tests on an LPDDR4 test signal with a data rate of 3200 megatransfers per second. The common approach towards running compliance or custom mode tests on a DDR4, LPDDR4 or LPDDR4X SDRAM device is that after configuring the SDRAM type and speed grade, we retain the default settings for burst triggering method and threshold settings. Then, in the Select Tests tab, we select one or more tests we wish to run. In this demonstration, let's select the Write Pre-amble and Read Pre-amble timing tests. Usually, in the Configure tab, we tend to retain the default settings for the signal and channel thresholds along with the other configuration options. Next, we ensure that the device under test is connected as per the instructions specified in the Connect tab, and that the physical setup is similar to the connection diagram displayed here. To run the selected timing tests, connect channel 1 of the oscilloscope to the differential clock pins of the LPDDR4 device under test. Then, connect channel 2 of the oscilloscope to the differential data strobe pins, and connect channel 3 of the oscilloscope to the DQ pin and ground pin of the LPDDR4 device. After validating the physical connections, let's proceed with running the selected tests. During the course of test runs with the default burst triggering method and threshold settings, the application is unable to find any valid write burst required for the write preamble timing test, and a valid read burst is also not found for the read preamble timing test, thereby leading to failures in the selected timing tests. To identify the appropriate burst triggering technique for such tests, let us consider two sets of DQS-DQ signals to see how the read-write bursts appear on each set and how to determine the burst separation method. Other than the set of the DQS-DQ signals that we are using in this demonstration to run the timing tests, let us first look at another set of LPDDR4 signals. For a single acquisition of the data strobe and data signals on channel 2 and channel 3 respectively, we look for any instances of unusual amplitude levels which indicate read bursts. Then we zoom in on that region of the waveform. Generally, we find adjacent read and write bursts in such instances. With proper scaling and overlaying of the DQS and DQ signals, let's first zoom in on the write burst. Notice that the signals are center aligned, that is, there is a phase difference between the DQS and DQ edges. Let's now zoom in on the read burst of the same waveform. Notice that the signals are edge aligned, that is, there is no phase difference between the DQS and DQ edges. Therefore, for such type of DQS and DQ signals, we must set the burst triggering method as DQS-DQ phase difference on the compliance test application. This is the default method used by the test application. The same concept of identifying phase difference between the DQS and DQ signals can be applied on DDR4 and LPDDR4X signals as well. Now, let us look at the original set of LPDDR4 signals to identify the burst separation method. For a single acquisition of the data strobe and data signals on channel 2 and channel 3 respectively, let's zoom in on the starting region of the write burst. Notice that this set consists of DQS write preamble pattern, which spans two clock cycles. Likewise, let's now zoom in on the starting region of the read burst. We are able to see the DQS read preamble pattern here, which also spans two clock cycles. This screen simultaneously displays the difference in the appearance of the DQS read and write preamble patterns, which were illustrated separately. For such set of LPDDR4 and LPDDR4X DQS and DQ signals, we must set the preamble pattern method for burst triggering. Note that preamble pattern is not available for DDR4 signals. If none of the previous conditions match to determine the burst triggering method, use the read or write only method on the compliance test application. In the set of signals used in this demonstration, another peculiar characteristic that can be noticed is that the read preamble pattern is toggling. Therefore, in this case, we shall change the read preamble pattern setting in the Configure tab from static to toggle. Apart from setting the correct burst triggering method, we must also verify that the threshold level values for the test signals are configured properly. The criteria for the compliance test application to identify any signal transition as valid is that the edge transitions must pass through the upper, middle, and lower threshold values of the signal. By default, the test application calculates signal threshold levels automatically using the top base ratio mode. This mode is useful for signals with uniform read-write burst amplitudes, such as the one shown here. However, for signals with complex patterns and varying amplitudes, Keysight recommends using the custom threshold mode, where you can configure signal threshold values manually. You may place markers to identify the upper, lower, and middle threshold values which cover all the edge transitions on the test signals. In order to ensure that the timing tests run successfully, let's verify and, if required, modify the threshold values in the User Configuration Setup Wizard accessible in the Setup tab. We first verify the signal measurement threshold settings. Here, we shall only focus on those settings that are associated with the signals used in this demonstration. For the timing test to run successfully, you must first verify that the reference DQ voltage is set to the proper value on the compliance test application. Using markers and with proper scaling, we are able to determine that the reference DQ voltage is set properly on the single-ended DQ signal. Next, we set the markers at the values predefined in the wizard for the input DQ high voltage and the input DQ low voltage. If all valid transitions pass through the markers, we can retain the pre-configured values. Else, readjust the markers to determine proper threshold values and modify the corresponding values in the wizard. The values set for the input DQ high and low voltage can also be used for the output DQ high and low voltage respectively. Now, let's acquire the differential DQS signal to verify its signal thresholds. Set markers to verify the input DQS high voltage and the input DQS low voltage, and then verify the output DQS high voltage and output DQS low voltage as well. Now, we must determine the burst threshold settings for each test signal. By default, the top base ratio mode is selected, which automatically calculates threshold levels at the defined ratio. While you may modify the ratio in this mode, it may not necessarily cover all edge transitions on complex signals. Therefore, select Custom Threshold to manually modify the upper, middle, and lower threshold values for each channel. Since data strobe signal was acquired on channel 2, and data signal on channel 3, we modify the threshold values according to the corresponding values modified earlier in the wizard. The input-output high and low voltage values for DQS and DQ signals correspond to the upper and lower thresholds on channel 2 and channel 3 respectively. Similarly, the VREF DQ value corresponds to the middle threshold on channel 3. After we verify all modifications done in the summary of changes area, we may exit the wizard. Note that the test application automatically updates the modified threshold values in the Configure tab as well. In this example, since Pre-amble pattern method is being used for burst triggering, you must ensure that the Pre-amble pattern trigger threshold values are configured properly for the DQS signal. The threshold values for the Pre-amble pattern trigger option in the Configure tab must match the respective channel threshold values for the DQS signal. After modifying the compliance test application with the appropriate settings for the test signal, let's run the timing tests once again. Now, we see that the test application uses the correct burst separation technique. Hence, it is able to determine several valid read and write bursts. Consequently, the read and write preamble timing tests run successfully. You may extend the fundamental concepts shown in this video to study the characteristics of other test signals as well, so that with proper configuration, you may run tests successfully using the DDR4 compliance test application. We hope that you found this demonstration useful. Watch out for more videos soon on Keysight.com that'll help you enhance test runs on the compliance test applications.